Okay, only tomorrow. So make sure you vote, carry out your rights as a citizen. Don't talk, just go and vote. Am I right? Is it everybody that's supposed to vote? Because all of you are looking like maybe I'm saying something wrong. Are you supposed to vote?
They are supposed to vote.
Good. So go and vote. Remember, I'm not promoting any party. It is not my business. But you must go and vote. If you do not vote, then the people you don't want will keep on ruling you. So you have a part to play in what you are getting. So you must learn to, for Christians, go and vote. You have to go and vote and make an impact on who you get. Praise the Lord. If we talk, and we don't vote, that is part of the problem. Hallelujah. So make sure you vote. Make time to go and vote. Just like you make time, of course, to come and worship God, you want to make sure that your children are not being ruled by dangerous people. So you have to vote. Hallelujah. At least in South Africa, I don't think, like some other countries that I shall not mention, even when you vote, the vote itself may not count. But in South Africa, they don't have that issue. So go and vote and make sure your vote counts. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Today we are concluding a series that was started 3-4 Sundays ago, titled Welcome Holy Spirit. Welcome Holy Spirit. I want you to say it after me. Welcome Holy Spirit.
Welcome Holy Spirit.
So you know you are not talking to me. You are not really just saying it after me. You are talking to God, who is already in you. Praise the Lord. Who you welcome is who you honor. Who you welcome is who you give attention to. When people enter into your house, enter into your presence, enter into where you are, and you don't say anything, obviously you don't honor them. And if they bring something with an intention to give unto you, they cannot, because there was no welcome. Many of us have Holy Spirit in us, but we don't welcome the Holy Spirit. We talk a lot about everything everybody does, don't say, but we don't welcome the Holy Spirit. I want to believe and pray that with the few things that we've said concerning the Holy Spirit, that you are not the same again. You are going forward. You are more aware of the Holy Spirit that is in you, guiding you, reminding you, empowering you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Am I in the house of God?
Amen.
If you will know that you are with me in the house of God, can you say amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. So let that amen sound like that every time we pray. Every time we declare into your life, you must say amen to sound like that. Because that is how everyone knows that you believe and you receive what has just been declared. Praise the Lord. Last week we began to finish off with an intention to conclude today with the functions of the Holy Spirit. We have said a few things about the Holy Spirit, and one of the key things we need to remember is the Holy Spirit is God, just like Jesus Christ is God, and God the Father is God. So it is God Himself having a plan for you and I, and God the Father created the whole world. For a reason. He put man in it for a reason. He went into the man, put him to sleep, and took the ring and used it to form the woman, and for a reason. Man fell, and yet God still forgave him, and he continued the plan of love that he has for mankind for a reason. He sent Jesus Christ for a reason. The same God that sent Jesus Christ also, after Jesus Christ went back to God, he didn't die. He sent another comforter for a reason. And now you are now here today. We have given our lives to Christ, and we are beginning that journey that we started on the day we gave our lives to Christ, and it doesn't end until when Jesus Christ comes again. And that is why we still have God in us, guiding us, helping us, reminding us, helping us to make the right decisions. When we pray, it's always there. When we are thinking, it's always there. Why? Because it's in us, and it will dwell in us forever. So we've said all this in so many ways, backed up with scriptures. Last week we made it clear that the Holy Spirit empowers us. The Holy Spirit will reprove us. Reprove us means He will admonish us, convict us. When we are born again and we have the Holy Spirit in us, we still say some things we shouldn't say, do some things we shouldn't do, and the Holy Spirit always lets us know. One of the things I like to say is there's no single adult who says they are born again who does not know where they are messing up. They know. So don't stress yourself over them. Just pray for them. They know what they're doing. They know what they're saying. It's either they are not born again and they said they are, or if they are born again, Holy Spirit has made them aware. So they know. They just pretend it like they don't know. So don't stress yourself over it. Just correct the Lord and pray for them. Holy Spirit reproves. He reproves us. He teaches us and reminds us. Why? Because we are human beings. We have the Spirit of God in us, but the flesh sometimes makes us forget things that we shouldn't be forgetting. But because the Holy Spirit is in us, He will bring, the Bible says, all things to our remembrance. You won't forget anything if you depend on the Holy Spirit. Amen. We're talking about the things that matter. We're not talking about maybe you have so much cloth in your wardrobe and you put green on Monday, yellow on Tuesday, orange on Wednesday, and then you forgot the one for Wednesday. Yeah, Holy Spirit is in us, but there's some things that are not the most important things for us. He reminds us of the things that may cause us to be in error or cause us to displease God. He will remind us. He guides us. He communicates truth to us. He hears what God is saying and He passes it on to us. He speaks to us. He shows us things. And that's why many of us, we like to say as Christians that we are being led of the Spirit, not by the flesh, not by emotions. Many people are in the right place and Satan used someone else to upset them. But because they are not led by the Spirit, but led by emotion, they leave the place of their calling because they are angry with someone. And they go around for years until one day when they are ready to listen to the Holy Spirit, He tells them, go back to where I last sent you, because I never sent you somewhere else. I pray that you and I will not wander. Oh, you are not again. We started again. I pray that you will not wander. Do you know? Let me tell you, it has to be spiritual. When people are praying and you don't say amen, it's either I can see that the Holy Spirit has led my wife to give a theme for the coming winning women. For those of you who are online, you would have seen. Are you a Martha or a Mary? When you have a lot of Marthas in one place, when you are praying, they don't say amen because their mind is on things. They are in church, but their mind is on things. They're already thinking about what they're going to eat, and they're in the house of God. Because you have to have a good reason. How you will not say amen when people are praying. And God help us if the people who lead us in worship are not saying amen to every prayer either. Praise the Lord. So I pray that you will not wander.
Amen.
I pray you will not jump from here to there.
Amen.
I pray that you will be led of the Spirit.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. We need the Holy Spirit in our lives because He inhabits us. He testifies of Jesus. He testifies of God as our Father. And when He testifies, it means that comes to our spirit too. We begin to, you know what? God is God. The enemy has thrown many things at you. You are thinking about it and suddenly you remember again because the Holy Spirit has reminded you, hey, don't listen to that nonsense. God is love. God is the way. God is the truth. He will make a way in that wilderness. He will create rivers in that desert place. Don't let it overwhelm you. God is in charge.
Amen.
Holy Spirit reminds us of these things. Today, I want to, as we conclude this series, I just want to answer some questions as a way of us concluding this series about the Holy Spirit. Because I don't want anybody to leave here today and having been with us in the journey talking about the Holy Spirit, and you are still clueless about the importance of the Holy Spirit in your own life. You have to know God yourself, and the Holy Spirit is already dwelling in you to help you to do that. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Holy Spirit just said I should do something right now. How many of you have your Bible with you? Don't worry whether it's electronic or physical. Raise your Bible. Let me see whether it's on the phone or not. Raise what your Bible is on. Because your Bible cannot be anywhere else than on your lap, in your hand, ready to be looked at. So that you can see what we are talking about. And from today, by the authority in the Word of God, and by the grace of God upon my life, never come to the presence of God or to His house without your Bible. The Bible describes the Word of God as a sword of the Spirit. In Ephesians chapter 6 from verse 10, God said, you and I should put on the whole armor of God. In that same verse, He said, that we may be able to withstand all the wiles of the devil. You want to live a victorious life? You need the Word of God.
Amen.
You want to keep on winning? You need the Word of God.
Amen.
You want to attend winning women meeting and actually be a winner yourself? You've got to have the Word of God and carry it with you. Have you seen any student, including young children, going to school and they don't have pen, they don't have paper, they don't have pencil? Will you even allow it? So why should it be okay for you to come into the house and the presence of God without the sword of the Spirit? Ephesians described among the whole armor of God, the shield, the helmet, the belts, the feet. The only one that is offensive, the one you use to attack, is the one that is described as a sword of the Spirit, with which you and I are able to withstand everything that the enemy will be throwing at us. So you need the Word of God, and we need to live a life of embracing it and showing the example that we are carrying the sword of the Spirit.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
One of the questions that we need to answer as Christians, as we are rounding up on the Holy Spirit, is when and how do we receive the Holy Spirit? When do we receive the Holy Spirit? Somebody will say, well, Pastor, you've already preached about that. Well, somebody is here for the first time too. They need to be part of the journey. We are now writing up and giving some key questions that you and I need to take away. When and how do we receive the Holy Spirit? And we're going to use the Word of God to define that. By the way, I was checking online early this morning and I realized that in Zulu, Holy Spirit is Umoya Ongwele. Am I right? Did I try? I knew that when I get here, people will laugh because my pronunciation might be wrong. Yeah? So I'm trying. So I'm going to get used to say that. Yeah? So when and how do we receive the Umoya Ongwele? We need to know. Praise the Lord. So that we are not making it look like these people we try to are the only ones who need to know about Holy Spirit. He's already in you and I since we have given our lives to Christ. Praise the Lord. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 12, verse 13, for by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and are being all made to drink into one Spirit. One Spirit. I believe Umoya is Spirit. Is it the other way? Umoya is Spirit. So we have all been made to drink. We have all been made to drink into one Umoya, one Spirit. When you walk out of here, the Holy Spirit is in you. When you come back in here, the Holy Spirit is in you. When you are going to work from tomorrow, the Holy Spirit is in you. Or maybe not tomorrow. When you are going to vote, the Holy Spirit is in you. I hope it's not like in some countries where on election day, certain people will be positioned in the polling stations. They will be bribing people with money in the eyes of everyone, including the whole world, on YouTube. Bribing people, and you prayed and you know to vote for, but because of money, you now vote for a different party. And then you are complaining for another 4 or 5 years about the government you are getting. But you've forgotten that you are one of the reasons why that government came into power. Holy Spirit is involved in all those things. He guides us. He reminds us. Many things you and I are doing today can affect our own children. The things you support may look like it didn't affect you, but it can affect your children. While you are busy saying Satan, God is reminding you it's not. It's you. You voted for that person, you voted for that government, you voted for that decision. And many times, the innocent ones are the ones who suffer for what we may do wrong. We have to be guided by the Holy Spirit. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. And we have been made to drink, all made to drink into one Spirit, one body. Romans 8 verse 9. But you are not in the flesh. How many people are not in the flesh here this morning? Okay, the others are in the flesh. Is that why you didn't raise your hand? How many people are not in the flesh here this morning? You can see, I'm watching. You see, every time we ask something, you have to answer. You can't be posting. If you don't get your hand, it might actually mean something satanic. So that's why you have to respond. How many people here are not in the flesh? Praise the Lord. I want to believe we are all in the Spirit according to the word of the Lord. He says there, Romans 8:9, you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if any man has not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Anybody who doesn't have the Holy Spirit is not of Jesus, because you wouldn't have the Holy Spirit and also not have, you wouldn't have Jesus and not have the Holy Spirit. So anybody who doesn't have that Spirit of God, that Spirit of Jesus in them, then they are not of Jesus. So when you and I say we are born again, we have to understand what we mean. The question is, when and how do we receive the Holy Spirit? We do receive it when we receive the Holy Spirit, when we proclaim Jesus, accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior, as our personal Lord and Savior. Praise the Lord. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 18 and 14, the Bible lets us know that, and I'm picking just in the center of it, after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. After you gave your life to Christ, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. Jesus said it about the Holy Spirit, that it will come. Then he said, the Holy Spirit will dwell in us forever. He promised the Holy Spirit to us, and it was fulfilled. And up to today, as many as believe that Jesus is the Son of God, they are saved. And confess with their mouth that is Jesus. They are saved. And once they do that, the Holy Spirit comes and it dwells in them forever. We became sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. I like the way the Passion Translation says this Ephesians 1, 13 and 14. And because of him, when you who are not Jews have the revelation of truth, you believe in the wonderful news of salvation. Now, we have been stamped with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. Verse 14 now says, he is given to us like an engagement ring. How many people have seen an engagement ring before? Or seen somebody with an engagement ring? Okay, it's not. They don't use an engagement ring in South Africa, okay. Because nobody raised their hand. So, you see, every time you don't respond, I have to depend on what you are doing or not doing as the answer. So, you don't do engagement, okay. In case you don't know, even from Bible times, people do engagement and then later on they get married. And so for the engagement, they give them a ring. So everybody can see they are not married yet, but this person is marked. Somebody owns that person. Well, in the sense of, this person belongs to that person. They are, you know, that's where people get the word fiance or fiance, depending on whether it's a male or female. They say they are now in a relationship or not. What the world calls boyfriend, girlfriend is more advanced now. Engagement is involved. And so the Passion Translation is letting you and I know. He said, he is giving to us like an engagement ring is given to a bride as the first installment of what is coming. Just like engagement is the first installment of a marital relationship. Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit, we're beginning to see as a first installment of what is coming before the day of the Lord. We are still in that journey, and we need to understand how we should relate with our God, with Jesus, and with our Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. In Message translation, it says, once you heard the truth and believed it, this message of your salvation found yourselves home free. Now, this is what I like, what it said. It said, signed, sealed, and delivered. Signed, sealed, and delivered. Once you are born again, you don't live in fear. You don't live believing that somebody has power over you anymore. You believe that he that is in you is greater than he that is within. And so you are walking in victory. You're walking as a winner. You're walking as a champion. Amen. If we don't think like champions, we cannot be champions. You've got to think it to be it. If we are racing champions, we who say we are racing champions are better be champions too. Because you can't raise what you are not. Somebody who's not a leader can never raise leaders. When I say leader there, nobody has a stamp of leadership on them. But when you are beginning to live your life in a way that leads others to Christ, you are a leader. You show example, you do things, you say things, you say the truth. If something is wrong, it's wrong. You don't gloss over it, you are already a leader, whether they give you a title or a position or not. And that's why some people, you might give them position of leadership. The way they talk, the way they decide, the way they relate with people shows that this one doesn't understand what comes with the position they were given. It comes with an expectation. For you to lead others, you have to be a leader in the spirit. So when and how do we receive the Holy Spirit? When we give our lives to Christ. When we believe in our heart and confess with our mouth Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of our life, then we are saved, and then we receive the Holy Spirit instantly. Another question I'd like to answer today as we conclude this series, how can I be filled with the Holy Spirit? When I become born again, when you become born again, the Holy Spirit indwells us. But if I say end there, because we're talking about a relationship here, you've got to relate with He who is dwelling in you. Can you imagine if you are a landlord and you let maybe one room in your house or one other outbuilding or building in your compound? You've let it out to somebody, and every time they're coming, they arrive from outside. They don't greet you. You don't greet them. You don't greet each other. Why do I need to greet him or her? Yeah, as long as they pay me my rent, you know. No relationship, no respect, no honor, no nothing. You just don't look at each other. How does that look? In the eyes of man, that does not look right. How much more our relationship with Holy Spirit? This morning, did you mention Holy Spirit when you woke up? Did you thank God, thank Holy Spirit when you woke up? God bless you, my brother. The brother there raised his hand. He didn't even wait for me. Because he loves, he honors the Holy Spirit. Did you actually realize it's in you and it's your personal friend?
Amen.
He wants to remind you of important things in your life.
Amen.
That is who Holy Spirit is. You are here today. You are newly born again. You met all these people. They've been born again before you, but you are newly born again. You have the same Holy Spirit that I have.
talk to him
this morning. I like saying good morning, Heavenly Father. Good morning, my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Good morning, Holy Spirit, my Comforter. I always like to start that way. Whichever way you want to recognize and appreciate and be conscious of the Holy Spirit who is dwelling in you. Praise the Lord. So how can I be filled with the Holy Spirit? Number one, for you to be filled with the Holy Spirit, you need to ask for his gifts. Because the dwelling in us of the Holy Spirit is the starting point. The filling of us with the Holy Spirit is the journey. That is how we grow. That is what shows that we are growing spiritually. So we are being filled by the Holy Spirit. Being filled with the Holy Spirit requires that you and I are asking for the gifts of the Holy Spirit, and we are believing that God will give it to us, give the gifts to us, and we will receive it. The Bible says in Matthew 7:7, ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and the door shall be opened. For he that asketh receives, he who seeks finds, and he who knocks, the door shall be opened. These are principles of the kingdom of God that you and I belong to. So because we have the Holy Spirit in us, all you need to do is ask. Many of us give our children gifts, don't we? Yeah? Do you give your children gifts?
Yes.
All right. So many of you are not responding on many things until I ask a second time. Look at that person next to you. Just ask them this question. Are you here? Okay. Because it's getting serious, isn't it? Since September 12, I've been in here every Sunday, and it's getting serious. We need to get rid of the matters, amen? In our lives, so we can be like the baby. Amen? Don't worry, don't stress yourself. You are in the house of God. Let it all go. Hear the word of God. Be free. Be released. Like people from another country in Africa say, as I don't mention, be calming down. Take it easy. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Holy Spirit is in you. The Holy Spirit is clapping for me right now. Yeah, tell them. I've been wondering. They don't play. They're taking it, you know, they should relax. Every time you don't say amen to prayer, it shows that your mind is on something else. So how can we be filled with the Holy Spirit? Ask for the gifts that God gives, and you shall receive the gifts that God gives.
Amen.
The gift of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
They are all listed in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Some of them, there are many more in the Bible, gifts that God gives. Right from Old Testament to New Testament, you will see the gifts that God gives. And those gifts are for us to profit the kingdom of God. In verse 7 of 1 Corinthians 7, the Bible says, each believer, how many believers are here? Praise the Lord. Each believer is given continuous revelation. Some people wait till when a popular preacher comes before they say there's revelation. They did not know that if they have been studying the Bible every day, God has been revealing himself to them every day. They don't need to be in a church program before they get God's revelation, unless Holy Spirit is not in them. Each believer is given continuous revelation by the Holy Spirit to benefit not just himself, but all. The gifts of God, King James Version will say, for the manifestation of the Spirit is given to everyone to profit without. But this version, which is the Passion Translation, says the same thing, but in a different way. It says each believer is given continuous revelation. So the revelation is not only on Sunday. It can be while you are sleeping. It can be while you are meditating. On Thursday, on Tuesday, on Friday. It could be any time. It could be right after the service on your way back home. Each believer, everybody here who is a believer, is given continuous revelation by the Holy Spirit to benefit not just himself, but all. There is something in my sister on this side that is in you, that Holy Spirit has put there, that makes you not just a blessing to yourself, but to everyone. There's a gift of the Holy Spirit in a brother on this side that Holy Spirit has put there, that if you use it obediently, not selfishly, it will bless not only you, but everybody else. That is the purpose of the gift. And those who really want to be a blessing in the house of God, in the life that God has given them, they will want to have a gift of the Holy Spirit so they can make spiritual impact.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Verse 11 of that 1 Corinthians 12 says, remember, it is the same Holy Spirit who distributes, activates, and operates these different gifts as he chooses for each believer. So it is the Holy Spirit actually that gave my brother the gift that he has, but I don't have that gift. So he cannot look at me and see he's more, he's holier than me. No, no, no. The gift was given by the Holy Spirit to all of us in the way he wants. So why would somebody glory with the gift God gave them as if they are so special? And they're now talking with that spirit. That is part of the disappointment of misunderstanding the scriptures. Once you begin to see a gift given by the Holy Spirit, as some entitlement, the person cannot be glorifying God with that gift. Because it was freely given, just like salvation. And so it's meant to freely be blessing others. In verse 1 of that same 1 Corinthians 12, look at what the Passion Translation said. He said, my fellow believers. So this letter was written by Paul to the Corinth church believers. These are believers, not unbelievers. He said, my fellow believers, as I'm saying now this morning, my fellow believers, I don't want you to be confused about spiritual realities. They are realities of the Spirit. And since we are born of the Spirit, we need to understand them. And don't let anybody pull a wool over our eyes and start taking advantage of us. Praise the Lord. So how can I be filled with the Holy Spirit? We need to learn to ask anything we want and know that we will receive it.
Amen.
If you ask for the gifts of the Holy Spirit, the impact that gifts of the Holy Spirit make on church, on ministry, on life, it will come through you. And since it's coming through you, it means you are also blessed already. But not only that, you are making impact beyond you. Because your mind is that you want to be a blessing. It's not just about you alone. You know, we like to say, it's not about me, myself, and I, the unholy trinity of flesh. Everything flesh is about me, myself, and I. But we is about God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
So when people are in the flesh, it's always about me, myself, and I, the unholy trinity of flesh. And that is not our portion in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Second answer to that same question, how can we be filled with the Holy Spirit, is by appreciating the difference between the indwelling of the Spirit and the filling. What is the difference when you are, when you have indwelling, as I said earlier and repeatedly over the journey of this series? It is for all believers. Once you are born again, you have the Holy Spirit in you. So the Holy Spirit is what is indwelling you. It's indwelling you. It is instant with salvation. Once you are saved, you have the Holy Spirit in you. You don't need to go and ask your uncle, ask your father, ask your mother, who is a reverend somewhere, or an in-law, who is a deacon somewhere. I gave my life to Christ in my church. What do you think? Do I have Holy Spirit? No, no, no. The Bible already says that you have Holy Spirit. There's some questions you shouldn't ask. You should just know them based on the word. Because if you ask questions that God has given you answers to already, you might get the wrong answer. and you may be misled. May you never be misled in the name of Jesus. John 14:16, and I will pray the Father, Jesus said, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. That is indwelling. Indwelling is also in John 7:37-39, where I just picked verse 38 there. He that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. That is Holy Spirit. Water there means Holy Spirit. Out of our bellies shall flow rivers of living waters. May that be you and I in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Out of our belly. Nothing fielding. No fielding looker, which is another way of describing greed for money, love for money. Nothing like that coming out of the belly, coming out of the mind. The person is always strategizing and calculating how to just, it's all about money, even in the house of God. Who? Where the Holy Spirit is, such a person will never be able to come to that kind of thinking. How much more even then act it and say it. The indwelling of the Holy Spirit, Jesus said, he will abide with you forever. And we see that just 7:38, he now says, if you believe on me, as the scripture has already said, so Jesus is letting us know, he's repeating what God has already told us severally, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. Galatians 3 verse 2, Good News Bible Version, says, tell me this one thing, did you receive God's Spirit by doing what the Lord requires? Or by hearing the gospel and believing it? It wasn't by law. It was by grace. It was by grace that you and I are saved through faith.
Amen.
That not of ourselves. It is the gift of God. Ephesians 2:8. Not by works, lest any man should boast. I think it's 2:9 and 10. Not by works, lest any man should boast. Nobody should come to you now and make it look like without them, you are not saved. No. Jesus Christ has come and redeemed us once and for all. Don't let anybody come and announce themselves as if they have now replaced Jesus in your life. He is still the way, the truth, and the life. He will remain like that forever.
Amen.
Don't let anybody take that place. Holy Spirit will remind you of that. Even that's what I just said now. Holy Spirit in you will remind you to not allow anyone to take the place of Christ in your life. So he's saying there, did you have the Spirit that you now have in you? Was it by law or by grace? By you hearing the gospel and believing it. And we know the answer is yes, by hearing the gospel and believing it. In 2 Corinthians 2, Good News Bible Version as well, it says, who has placed his mark of ownership upon us? That's what has happened. When you and I have called on the name Jesus, and we now have Holy Spirit in us, there's a mark that has been placed upon us, that we are owned by God. We belong to God. We don't belong to Satan. That mark is already on us. And who has given us the Holy Spirit in our hearts? The guarantee, as the guarantee of all that he has in store for us. The Holy Spirit in you and I is the guarantee that God has a lot of wonderful, great, mighty, God-glorifying things in store for us. But you have to believe it. And you have to keep on welcoming the Holy Spirit into your life that way, with that same mind. What about feeling? Remember the question is, in answering the question of how do we be filled with the Holy Spirit, we said, well, there's two parts to it. There is the need for us to appreciate the indwelling of the Holy Spirit and the feeling of the Holy Spirit. If we don't talk about the feeling of the Holy Spirit, we will all go around boasting that I'm born again. I gave my life to Christ on this date or this year. And that's it. We still do what we like. Talk how we like. Think how we like. Don't fellowship. Don't come to church. Don't not accountable to anybody. We come where we want to come. Where we don't want to come, nobody can see. You know, we just continue to live our lives like that. Holy Spirit is still indwelling that person. But are they filled with the Holy Spirit? That is a progressive work. Where indwelling is instant upon salvation, filling of the Holy Spirit is forever. It is continuous. It is progressive. It is continuous. It is ongoing. It is a life of submission to God through the Holy Spirit. It is a life of obedience to God. It is a life of knowledge of the Word of God. You want to be filled with the Holy Spirit? It is a question that is being asked. Then you need to continually study the Word of God. The Bible says in 2 Timothy 2:15, study to show yourselves approved unto God. A workman that needs not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Rightly dividing the word of truth. That is feeling. Because as you study the word, your mind begins to change. The word of God is the mind of God. The word of God is the way of God. The word of God is the will of God. The word of God is the truth. Capital T. So the minute you begin to develop your life studying that word, which is God Himself, then you begin to be filled with it. If you are more informed about politics than about kingdom of God, you will speak more, isn't it, of politics. Everything you want to, even when you want to advise a young person, you will always use some political thing to advise them, because that's all that person has in them. All of their knowledge is about politics. All of their knowledge is about money. So that's all they can use to advise. But when you are filled with the Word of God, you are filled with the Holy Spirit. You are filled with the Holy Spirit. And it's continuous. John 4:24 says, God is Spirit. John 1:1 says, God is Word. So therefore, Word is Spirit. So when you study the Word, you are filling yourself with the Spirit of God. When you study the Word, you are filling yourself with the knowledge of God. You begin to think like God. That was the intention. That was the plan of God. Anyway, we are just cooperating with God's plan. And that is what true Christians do. When you are filled with the Holy Spirit, sin cannot hinder you. When you are filled with the Holy Spirit, it means Holy Spirit takes over every aspect of your life. You know, you're always talking about Holy Spirit when it comes to having children, when it comes to being a good husband, good wife. Oh, Holy Spirit, when you want to make more money for your company, your turnover this year, you didn't like it, you want it to increase by another 50%. You are always talking about Holy Spirit. But when it comes to giving unto God, tithe. But Holy Spirit gives you freedom to give, freedom to be a blessing, freedom to be holy, freedom to do the right things, freedom to be a law-abiding citizen of the country where you are. Because you are truly engaging with the Holy Spirit and He's gradually filling you. Not because He can't fill you instantly, but because the filling requires your own cooperation, your submission, your obedience. It's my money now. Why can't I use this job by a second car that me and my wife don't need? And Holy Spirit kept on telling you, there are 10 people around you. You know them, they know you. You hug them. You quote scriptures to them. And they need a car. You keep on quoting scripture. You talk holy to them, but you need to act holy. Holy Spirit said, give them that car. Let them come to church like you come regularly. And you're discarding it. You're still looking to have 2 cars, 3 cars, and you don't need. Holy Spirit gets involved in everything. Everything. Filling or the Holy Spirit requires that you do the word. As you do the word, you are filled with the Holy Spirit. Because it's discipline. We were doing a discipleship course here. Just yesterday, we concluded the two Saturdays with leaders, and we were talking about this. Our outward acts are connected. Our innermost thoughts and motives of our actions are connected. When you are being filled with the Holy Spirit, it's because you have allowed the word to dictate how you do things. Even when you are thinking, you allow the word to penetrate the dividing asunder of soul and spirit. Hebrews 4:12 says, and the word is what? Quick, powerful, sharp, sharper than a two-edged sword, piercing to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit. The word will get to the recesses of your mind. It says, piercing to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and the joints and the marrow. And then he now said, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. When you go to the word of God and keep on studying day and night, meditating on it day and night, you will see that the word, it will just jump at you that, wow, this has answered what I'm thinking. Not what you are saying, what you are thinking. The word of God will penetrate. And it's a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. What are you thinking? What are you planning? The word of God will get there, and as that happens, and you are allowing it and not opposing it, you will find that you are being filled with the Spirit. Praise the Lord. Yeah. What about your body? When you are filled with the Spirit, you are careful about how you treat your body. And we're not talking about sex alone. People always think it's about sex alone. It's also about every other greediness and lying and cheating and sowing discord and lying against people and doing wrong things and running into mischief. Anything to harm others, lie against them, victimize them, persecute people, whether they deserve it or not, we are not supposed to do it at all. All of that has to do with the body, the flesh. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20, Good News Bible Version says, don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who lives in you and who was given to you by God? You do not belong to yourselves, but to God. It's always good when we read things like this so that people don't think we're just saying this. The Bible says so. God is saying that to us. He bought you for a price. So you are not ordinary. You are so special in the eyes of God. But are you treating yourself that way? Are you treating your life that way? Are you treating your spirit that way? Are you treating your mind that way? Are you treating your body that way? He bought you for a price. So use your bodies for God's glory. So the way you dress is part of it. This is not about wear. This one I like to wear. We are all Christians. Don't judge me. We are not judging you. All we are saying is what you are wearing is affecting that brother. That brother is a single man. He's so single for marriage. But at the moment, he's not strong enough to know how to keep his eyes straight. And you are dressing dangerously. So you need to learn how to dress. We are not judging you. We are just thinking about the others. I'm very sure when I was nearly born again, I must have distracted some people too. Because I came out of nightclub and was saved. So even though my soul has been saved, my dancing moves have not been saved. So I'm sure when I was dancing, people from behind are possibly fainting in the spirit and distracted in the spirit because I'm dancing dangerous dance. I didn't know. I'm really born again. The Bible doesn't teach you how to dance, but the word of God teaches you to do is how to care for others. How to be sensitive about others. How to care that, what am I doing? I like it, but if I like it publicly, will it bless people? Will it lead them to Christ or distract them? That is part of it. And the relationship we have with the Holy Spirit helps us in all these simple matters of life. So that even if you are doing it in ignorance yourself, not deliberately, God knows. But through the word of God, he's beginning to fill you with himself, so you are now aware. Nobody came to you, and you just knew that, you know what, nobody came to me today, but Holy Spirit is letting me know the way I dress today must be distracting. I remember conversations I've had in the past. We see it in a light way, because it's other things we're talking about, like younger ladies, and they come to people like us for some counsel on so many matters. And one of the things I used to say, I just remember that, is once you are dressed as a lady and you come into the public place and you find yourself using your hand, every second, it shows that your dressing was not right. If your dressing was right, why you are adjusting every second? You're pulling this, you're okay. It's a sign that you need to begin to care about your body enough to know that Holy Spirit is involved with you. Spirit, soul, and body.
Amen.
He doesn't want you to distract others. So he will let you know, hey, don't wear that. Give it away. In fact, there's some things that you have, you wanted to give away, but you've grown to another level, you now realize, I can't keep this one. Because I don't want another person to wear what I've decided is not right for me to wear.
Yes.
You get rid of it completely. Let the companies go and recycle it. Don't give it to another. Because once you give people a gift, they feel forced to use it. Listen, there's something about gifts. You want to use it. You want to see that the person who gave it to you can see you wear it. That means you are making that person do what you have just ignored. You've walked away from that, and you are allowing someone else to walk in it. So all these things are connected. I have to break it down this way so that you know the Holy Spirit is involved in everything. Oh my brother, you are too spiritual. There's nothing called too spiritual. Holy Spirit is involved in your spirit, your soul, or mind, and body. You can't get away with doing what you like in any of those departments and still say you are filled with the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. Does that mean somebody won't do something that doesn't show all these things I say, that they are filled with the Spirit? It can happen. But we are not judging them. We're encouraging each other to focus this way, concerning the Holy Spirit in us. And as that is happening, God is merciful, God will correct us, Holy Spirit will remind us, Holy Spirit will remove us, all those things we said. And the person will adjust, even without nobody telling them, because they are already actively engaging with the Holy Spirit that is dwelling in them. If you're actively engaging, like our parents, we do things that are wrong, they see it once, they see it twice, they didn't say anything. Third time they tell us. When they tell us, they're not beating us, they're not doing anything, they're just telling us. And then before you know it, we stop. They didn't stop being our parents, they didn't disown us because of it, but they made us aware. And that's how the Spirit is in us. You will always know when you are doing something that God doesn't approve of. And I pray that you and I will live our lives honoring God. Praise the Lord. Another question I want us to answer, I have two more, and I want to answer there as we conclude this topic very quickly. How do you know if you are a spirit-filled believer or not? Now that we are talking about indwelling of the Holy Spirit and filling of the Holy Spirit as something that we need to know the difference between the two, so that we don't feel too relaxed and just do what we like since we are born again. We now know that the filling is continuous, is progressive. It speaks of submission. It shows that you are obedient. It shows that you honor God. It shows that you want to please God. That's the infilling, the filling of the Holy Spirit. But how do I relate with the Holy Spirit that is in me already? How many people have the Holy Spirit in there? I'm just checking. Yes. If you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I possibly said this 20 times in the journey, you have the Holy Spirit. You must not doubt it. Because the minute you doubt, you will not be able to draw all the power that you already have. You'll be waiting for someone else to collect rent from you before you have that power. You can't buy it. Three things I want us to remember. for us to relate with the Holy Spirit the right way. Do not resist the Holy Spirit. Resist means oppose. That is, do not do what is opposite to what the Holy Spirit said. You know, one example that I give over the years, and I think my wife and I were talking, she reminded me of that example, which I didn't remember until she mentioned it again, is Holy Spirit gets involved even in matters like you want to wear yellow suits today. And Holy Spirit already knew that in 2 hours' time, by the time you get to church, because you love children, they always come and hug you. They jump, they run and, you know, grab you at that speed. And you are going to have a Rabina in your hand. And it's going to spill on you. Now, you don't know what that is. Holy Spirit knew. So Holy Spirit said, don't put on yellow. I was discarded. Oh, I've stored up this yellow. Today is the day for yellow. Today is the day for yellow. You just put it on. And the first guy that came to me, maybe a child called Jeremy, just came, always public. And he just, with your rabbina and everything just spilled over your head. So, and the minute it happened, what happened? You remember, Holy Spirit told you. There's always something simple that happens in our life sometimes, and you know, Holy Spirit told me. Or, Holy Spirit told you. Yeah. So do not resist the Holy Spirit. Do not resist the Holy Spirit. I think in Zulu, it means Negamelani Nomoya Ngwele. Am I right? Do not resist the Holy Spirit. Do not, even my wife is surprised. She didn't know what I'm doing. I'm trying to see her expression today. She didn't know. She has been showing up with some words since we came. I never had time, so we're not going to be, I know we're going to be competing from now. I think that way we will learn faster. Acts 7 verse 51. The Bible says, ye stiff-necked people, and uncircumcised in heart and ears, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost, as your fathers did, so do ye. I don't want you and I to be one of those who are stiff-necked. I think I was demonstrating stiff-necked maybe on a Tuesday, last week, during Bible study. Some of you need to be coming to Bible study. Church is not waiting for anything. The church is going on. You have to be part of church. You need to be in Bible study. You need to be in prayer meetings, on Thursdays, Bible study, on Tuesdays. Don't come only on Sunday. We can't do everything only on Sunday. Be part of the journey. Stiff-necked means stubborn. So God is saying in his word to these people that they are stiff-necked, they are stubborn, uncircumcised in their heart. That is, their heart is like the heart of matter, always full of stuff. I need to do this. I need to have that. Oh, this one said this. That one said that. The one that concerns them, the one that doesn't concern them, the one that belongs to them, the one that doesn't belong to them, the one they should do, the one they should do. Everything is all locked together. Matter. I hope I'm not preaching the message of winning women. I love that topic. I love that topic. Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost, as your fathers did, so you are also doing now. The word is saying, I pray that that will not be your now. But remember in Deuteronomy 10:16, Good News Bible Version says, so then, from now on, be obedient to the Lord and stop being stubborn. That's the Good News Bible Version. The Message translation of that same verse says, so cut away the thick calluses from your heart and stop being so willfully hard-headed. Don't be hard-headed. In my language also, hard-headed, there's a way we say it to you. Don't be hard-headed when it comes to Holy Spirit. Don't be headstrong. Don't be stubborn. Don't oppose what the Holy Spirit is saying. As you continue to do that, you are relating with the Holy Spirit the right way. And it prompts you answer. When it reminds you acknowledge. When you wake up, you welcome Him. When you are in the bus, you welcome Him or taxi. When you are on the way to work, you welcome Him. When you are about to make an important decision, your career, your business, your family, you welcome the Holy Spirit. Just do it continually. If you do that continually, you'll be filled with the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. So stiff-necked people are stubborn, obstinate, self-willed. They do what they want to do. Doesn't matter whether it's relevant, right, helpful to other people. They just do it because they want to do it. I pray that God will not give you an eye. It is not a way to relate with the Holy Spirit who is in us. Secondly, do not grieve. We are answering that question. How do I relate with the Holy Spirit as we conclude? Do not grieve the Holy Spirit. Grieve means sadden. Don't make the Holy Spirit sad. Just like a parent can be sad. They won't disown that child, but they can be sad because this boy, this girl, keeps on disobeying, keeps on doing what he likes or she likes, keeps on not honoring what they say. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit with your decisions, with your lifestyle, with how you live your life, how you talk, how you think, how you act. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit. You know, in Sulu it says, Ninganda Bukisi Umoya Ngwe. See, I'm getting there. I like the way people are not here encouraging me. So at least my pronunciation shows that it is what I said, it is okay. So I know it won't be perfect yet, but we're getting there. Ephesians 4, 30 to 32. It says, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God. Don't make the Spirit of God sad. He's in you already. No doubt. If you are born again, it's in you. Don't wait for someone else to come and tell you. It's in the word. So, but do not sadden him. Do not make him sad. Do not make him sad. And how do you do that? Verse 31 tells us. It says, let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And in verse 32, it now says, and be ye kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven you. Can you see? When we say somebody is too spiritual, what do we mean? Because they are trying to ensure that they connect spirit, soul, and body. You know, that's what they're doing. So how can you say they're too spiritual? What do you want them to do? To not be that anymore? So do not grieve the Holy Spirit. And thirdly, do not quench the Holy Spirit. Ninga usimi umoya ngwele. Is this simi or kimi? C-I-M-I. Okay. Ninga usimi umoya ngwele. Do not quench the Holy Spirit. Quench means extinguish. When there's fire going on and it's dangerous fire, it's not fire, what do? You get fire extinguisher. I hope we have one in this place. Amen. Because we have science. The science must not lie. Okay, praise the Lord. I can see hands pointing where they are to be. Praise the Lord. For those of you online, so you know, we have fire extinguisher. When there's strange fire or dangerous fire, we shall extinguish it. But when there's a fire of the Holy Ghost, we shall dance in it, swim in it, praise in it.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Do not sadden the Holy Spirit. Make sure. But do not quench, is what we're talking about now. Don't extinguish. Don't put it out. Don't kill the light, the fire of God that is in you. Don't kill it. There's a ring light here, right before me. The ring light gives light. If we switch it off, it does not give light. But does that thing have power to give light? It does. But we switch it off. The Holy Spirit in us is like fire. We are not supposed to switch him off. Don't quench the fire of the Holy Ghost that is in you. If it burns in you and you don't quench it, and the next person it burns in them and they don't quench it, and there are 500 of us in one place, and each of us don't quench the fire, what do you think will happen already to any satanic spirit that wants to enter anywhere where we are? It will see us one way and it will flee how many ways? 7 ways, according to scriptures. So do not quench the spirit. 1 Thessalonians 5:19. That is all he said in that verse. Quench not the spirit. Fire can be quenched, but the promptings of the Holy Spirit can be stifled or muffled or muted by us when we are not relating right with the Holy Spirit. So to relate with the Holy Spirit, in answer to that question, we must not grieve the Holy Spirit, we must not quench the Holy Spirit, and we must not resist the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. Are we getting something today? Are we excited to have the Holy Spirit in us? Praise the Lord. We must continue to live our life as Spirit-led believers, Spirit-filled believers. If you are here today, you don't have Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Let me tell you with the boldness of Jesus, but without any disrespect to you, that you cannot have the Holy Spirit we're talking about unless you have Jesus Christ. The power, therefore, to speak the things that be not as though they were, it cannot exist in the person who doesn't have Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. I don't want you to live your life depending on man. I want you to live your life depending on God, depending on Jesus, depending on the Holy Spirit, and knowing that you have the Word of God dwelling in you richly. If you are here today, don't look at anybody. Don't check whether they are good. You want to give your life to Christ. I want you to come forward. If you are here today, you want to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. You are fed up trying to be defensive every time people ask you, are you born again Christian? Then you stand and say, what do you mean born again? As if you didn't know what they meant. But it's because you cannot confidently say you are. Maybe you are not. I want you to come forward. And also, if you are here, you know you are born again. You know at some time in the past, you have given your life to Christ. You meant it. You knew. You are conscious of it. But you know that you can't even think of any relationship you have developed with the Holy Spirit in you. And you want to use today this opportunity that God is giving you as a way to refresh and reawaken unto righteousness. I want you to also come forward to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You want to rededicate your life to Christ and be accountable to Him from now on. You want to live your life in a way that shows you are truly who you say you are. I want you to also come forward. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So I want to believe everybody here, you have Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. So everything we've said already, ensure that you take them. Don't forget them. Go back to the Word. Search the Scriptures daily, like the Christians in Berea in Acts 17. Search daily the Scriptures and make sure that you do the Word. Make sure that you relate with the Holy Spirit who already dwells in you. May that be your portion in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Can I ask everybody to stand up as we close?